Hello everyone. So in today's class we are going to study the two standard we are going to study. One is nothing but the POSIX.1 FIPS and one more is X/Open Standard. So this is the two standard we are going to see other than the POSIX. So we know that what is POSIX, right? So the POSIX is nothing but which is a portable operating system for the interface. So for what purpose it is developed? To provide interface between the different types of the Unix operating system. So the POSIX is came into exist, which provide a standard API for all the Unix versions, right? So now POSIX.1, POSIX.1b, POSIX.1c are the different versions of the POSIX, right? So the POSIX.1, so it is going to support for the basic operating system, right? So the last class we are seeing what is POSIX.1, so how, for which purpose we are going to make use of the POSIX.1, right? So the POSIX.1 will be used in the basic operating system, and also it will be mainly used for the file operations related information. Now the POSIX.1 is going to introduce a standard. So now what is that standard? So that standard will be given for the user. Now the user is going to follow that standard and he is going to make use of that APIs and he is going to develop his own application. So for that purpose POSIX.1 is also introduced the standard. So what is that standard name? That is FIPS. So what is that FIPS? Is nothing but the federal information processing standard. Now the FIPS, what it is? It is a standard. So what it is? Federal Information Processing Standard. So for the federal company in the US, so they developed the standard. They introduced the standard for the US federal. So for that purpose, the name is Federal Information Processing Standard. So this is the standard which is introduced in the POSIX.1. So which is developed by the which one? That is NIST, that is there in the US. So what is that NIST? So NIST is nothing but the National Institute for Standard and Technology. So what is that NIST? The NIST is nothing but the National Institute for Standard and the Technology. Now this POSIX.1 FIPS is going to follow the more restriction than the POSIX.1. So let us see what are the restrictions. So there is a 8 restriction is there. So we are going to see one by one. First one, job control. So the POSIX.1 is going to support the job control. So hope you remember the test macro, that is the POSIX job control. So this is the test macro, right? So what we studied in the job control test macro, so we are seeing that the POSIX is going to follow the BSD, that is the BST style job control. So how, which style it is going to follow? That is the Barclay Unix operating system style style job control it is going to use. How it is going to work? We are seeing it is going to switch from the background to the foreground. So this is going to be defined in the POSIX.1 FIPS also. So second one, saved set UID and the set GUID. So what are they? So it is also going to make use of the one of the test macro, that is the POSIX saved IDs. So now set saved set UID and the set GID is also going to be supported in the POSIX.F.1.FIPS standard. So what are they? So we know that whenever the user is going to log in, it is going to automatically assign the saved user ID and the saved group ID, right? So when the value is -1, so the user is going to can change into the effective user ID and the GID for the modification of a file. Otherwise, he cannot. So this is going to be supported in the POSIX.1.FIPS also. Now the third one, long path name is not supported. So we are seeing though one more, that is the POSIX. In the POSIX, we are seeing the POSIX no trunk. So we are seeing though the one of the test macro, that is POSIX no trunk. So what do you mean by that? So it is not going to be supported in the POSIX.1.FIPS. So when the POSIX no trunk it is having the -1, indicate that it automatically going to truncate the long path. So it is going to truncate the long path into the name bytes. So now if the value is not a -1, it is not going to be truncated automatically. So this is what not going to be supported in the POSIX.1.FPS. So now the next one, the next test macro it is going to be defined is POSIX CH1 restricted. So we know that we can change the ownership of the file, right? So when the value is -1, if the value is -1, the any user can access that one, and any user can change the ownership, right? So when it is the -1, so if the value is not -1, so if the value is not -1, then though only the special user that we are going to call it as a super user. So the super user can going to change the ownership of the file. So now in the POSIX.1.FIPS, the value of the CH1 restricted is not a -1. So but in the POSIX, its value is -1 by default. Now next one, POSIX VDisable. So we know that the POSIX VDisable is the one more macro. So what it indicate that if the value is -1, so it is nothing but then it is not going to be able to change the meaning of the special character in the terminal device file, right? So you cannot change the meaning of the special character. So when the POSIX VDisable value is -1, so otherwise, so in the POSIX.1.FIPS it is tells that if the value is not a -1, so that is nothing but though you can change the special meaning of the character which is there in the terminal device file. Now the N group maximum value is how much in the POSIX? It was 0, but in the POSIX.1.FIPS the value is going to be 8. So that is what the N group max. So what is that N group? That is the simultaneous group you can created at a time. That is the in the POSIX the value was 0. Here the POSIX.1.FIPS the value will be 8. So now when we are going to make use of the read and write API, so we are going to use the read API for reading the file. To write the content to the file, we are going to make use of the write API. So that is nothing but the read API, and the next one is the write API. So these are the API we are going to use for reading and writing the file, right? So now suppose while writing some data to the file, now suppose for example this is a file, now you are keep on writing the data to the this file. Now in middle the signal is going to be interrupt. The signal is going to be inter. So in that cases, so whatever the data is there, that has to be written in which one? In the POSIX.1 FIPS. So that is what the read and write APIs. Now next one, group ID. So as I said, when the user is going to log into the Unix operating system, when the user is going to log into the Unix operating system, user or any consider POSIX.1 or anything. So now when the user is going to log into this operating system, it is going to automatically assign the UID and the GID, that is the user identification number and the group identification number automatically. So when the user is going to create any file here, that is the r.txt. So now for that, the group ID and the UID will be there. For which one? For the directory. Now the directory. Now whatever the directory's UID and the GID is there, the same UID and the GID will be initialized to the file also. So this is what the 8 point the FIPS is going to be given. So now with this you can say that the POSIX.1 FIPS is more restricted than which one? Than the POSIX. So this is about the POSIX.1 FIPS standard. Now we are going to move on to the one more standard. Let us study the one more standard, that is X-Open standard. So why they are introducing this many standard, that is the POSIX standard, so the POSIX.1 FIPS standard and the X-Open standard. So why they are introduced? So only to provide a standard application programming interface, to provide a standard APIs for all the versions of the Unix operating system, they introduce this many standard. So now X-Open standard. So now this is the one of the standard, so which is formed by the European companies. So the European companies, they grouped together and they form the X-Open standard. So for which purpose? To provide a common interfaces, to provide a common operating system interfaces among all the operating system, they are introduced the X-Open standard. Now for what purpose they are introduced? To provide interfaces, right, among the operating system. So now this X-Open standard introduce the guideline. So what that guideline is? Nothing but that is the X-Open portability guide. So that we are going to call it as a XPG. So in the year 1994, they introduced these guidelines. Now that guidelines will be given to all the user who are present in the European company. They make use of these guidelines to work with the X-Open standard. Now what it is going to provide, which is going to provide these guidelines, what it contains? It contains all the functionality of the C and as well as the C application programming interfaces for all the Unix system. So which is going to provide the information about what are the C function it is going to provide, what are the facilities is there in the C programming, and what are the application programming interfaces we are going to use in the C. So that is given as a guideline to the user to work with the X-Open standard. So now after that, in the 1993, so other than this, in the 1993, the one more vendors, that is nothing but all the vendors, they group together and they are introduced the one more common operating system. So what you are going to call it as a, that is nothing but the COSE. So what is that COSE? It is nothing but the open software environment. environment. So the in the 1993, all the group of computer vendors, they introduced the common operating system, that is the common software environment. They are introduced that we are going to call it as a COSC. Now this COSC is going to be used. So for what purpose? To provide a single programming interfaces, to provide a single programming interface specification, they introduced this one. So that specification, what we are going to call it as a, that is the X/OpenCAE. So that is X/OpenCAE. So what is that CAE? So the CAE is nothing but the common application environment. So the common application environment. So now the specification they are introduced in the year 1993, that is nothing but the X/OpenCAE. So the which is going to be used for the common programming language, that is the COSC, that is the common open software environment. That is nothing but anybody can access this standard and they are going to work with this standard. So this is what the X/Open standard. So now let us see how the POSIX and the UNIX is going to support the application program interfaces. Let us study the UNIX and the POSIX APIs. So now we come across what is UNIX operating system. So what is POSIX operating system? So now in this chapter, we are going to study the information about the APIs. That is the application program. That is what it is. It is a application program interface. So now we are going to study what are the application programming interface the UNIX and the POSIX operating system is going to support. So what is the restriction is there? So what are the error we are going to get while making use of the APIs? All that information we are going to study one by one. So now before going to that, let us see what is that API indicate. So what is that API? API is nothing but the application programming interfaces. So whom they are going to make use? It is going to be used by the user program, right? So these APIs will be make use in the where? In the user program. So for what purpose we require the API? To access the system information and to perform the system specific operation we require the APIs. So in the single word, we can say that API is a application programming interface which is going to be make use in the user program. For what purpose? To make use of the system specific operation. To perform the system specific operation, we are going to make use of the APIs in our program. So that is nothing but the API. Now how this API is going to be used in the UNIX operating system? So we know that in the beginning we have studied that what is kernel, right? The kernel is the core of the UNIX operating system that is going to manage all the file processing, all that operation it is going to manage, right? So now we are having the two important mode. One is user mode and the another one is a kernel mode. Now the user mode, suppose for example the user mode, they are going to execute some API, that is system related APIs they are going to execute. So now what happens? The control will be given to which one? That is the kernel mode. So when the user enters the API, the control will give us to the kernel mode. Now though, make use of the data and the resources which are present in the kernel mode. Now after execution, so what happens? The control will be given back to the user. Now there is a switching, right? So there is a switching operation between the user mode and the kernel mode when you are going to make use of the APIs. Now when you are going to make use of APIs, there will be a context switching, right? So from the user mode to kernel mode, kernel mode to the user mode. So that's why it is a better to make use of whenever the API is required. So don't use unnecessarily. So that is what the one of the important point you have to remember before making use of the API. Now as I said, API is the application programming interface, then make it use little. So don't waste the kernel resource and the data. So what API is going to provide? So this API is going to provide though many APIs for though some specific application. Suppose for example, first one, for the system configuration, that is to get the system configuration detail and the user information. User information, we are going to make use of the APIs to get the system configuration and the user related information. Now I want to know though who is the owner of the file. So now in that cases you can make use of the user information. Now I like to know though what is the maximum number of the bytes to create an a file name. So that is going to be supported in the system configuration. So to fetch that information, the API is required. Now second one, you can make use of the file manipulation. So file manipulation. To perform the file manipulation, we are going to make use of the API. For example, to write some data to the file, to read the data to the file, so to seek the file, that is to search the specific character in the files. So in that cases you are going to do the file manipulation. For that the specific API is there. So other than that, we are having the process creation, and the control. So for process creation and the control, we are going to have the specific API. Suppose for example, the fork is the one of the important process creation API. So all these things, so other than that, we are having the inter-process communication. So we know that the multiple processes will be supported in the Unix operating system. When the program is executed, program is going to be executed, so there will be plenty of the process, that is P1, P2, likewise P3. So this is nothing but the process, right? So there will be plenty of process it is going to create while executing the program, under execution, to provide a communication among this process. So you can share the message, you can share the memory, so you can make use of the semaphore. So all this operation you can perform for while communicating with this process, that we are going to call it as an inter-process. So for that there will be a specific applications. Now suppose a last one is nothing but the network related information. To get the network related information, suppose for example I like to send the email to someone, so in that cases there will be a specific API. So this main application is there to make use of the APIs in your program. So based on which operation, which application you are using, so that application you can select, and under that there will be plenty of APIs. You can make use of that APIs. So for what purpose? It is going to reduce the coding part. So that's why it is going to provide the APIs for the user, that is predefined APIs. So now this is about what? This is about the APIs, right? So how the user mode, kernel mode, what are the application it is going to support? Now POSIX APIs. So what is the POSIX APIs? The POSIX APIs, which is derived from the Unix API. APIs. As we know that to provide interface among the different versions of the Unix, we are introduced the POSIX, right? So now this POSIX APIs is also derived from which one? From the Unix operating system. So now other than that, Unix operating system APIs, so it has its own API. So what are they? Suppose for example, inter-process communication. So that will be going to be supported in the POSIX API also. So the inter-process, as I said, it is going to send the messages, or it is going to share the memory, or it is going to make use of the semaphore. So in that cases, it has its own API. So to include these APIs, so what we required, we already studied that the two important header is required. In which one? In the POSIX operating system. So in every program, we are going to include the two important header, that is the POSIX source, and the one more is POSIX C source. So these are the header, right? So this is nothing but the version, that is the value we are going to give. So now these are the two headers we have to include in our program. For what purpose? To include the POSIX API in our program. So this is about the POSIX API. Now let us see though, what are the APIs and how the POSIX environment is going to support that APIs. Let us see the last topic in this module, that is the first module, the Unix POSIX development environment. So how the Unix and POSIX development environment is going to support the APIs. So we know that for including any APIs, we require the one header, right? So that header, we are going to call it as a unistd.h. So that is what we are seeing in the earlier. So now other than that, we also seen the one more important statement, that is p error. So suppose for example, any API you can use, that is the open API. So in that cases, so whenever the open API is not going to work, so in that cases, you can display the diagnostic error messages by using the p error. That is P error not open, that is though not open properly, or a invalid file name. So you can give any error message to display it in a P error function. So this will be used for displaying the error message when the API is not going to be work, right? So when the API is going to unsuccessful, then you can make use of the P error message. Now other than that, so all the APIs, right? So open API, read API, or consider fork API, you can consider any API that is going to be contained the object code, right? So how this open API should work? So how the read function is going to work? So how the fork function is going to work? So all that function definition, that is nothing but the object code. So that object code for the all the APIs will be stored it in a two important library in the POSIX, that is nothing but the libc.a, and the one more is libc.so. So these are the two libraries where we are going to get the object code for all the APIs which is supported in the Unix as well as the POSIX operating system. Now, what is the API common characteristics? So we are having the four important common characteristics among all the APIs. So we know that API is application programming interfaces. Now, if you are going to use any API, it is going to return the integer value. So this is the integer value it is going to return. Suppose for example, open system call. So now open is a API. Now when you are going to use this one, either it is going to return the pointer, or it is going to return the what? Minus 1. When it is unsuccessful. Most of the APIs is going to return the minus 1 value. When there is a failure. So when there is a failure in the API, the minus 1 value it is going to return. That is the integer value. Now other than that, although whatever the error it is going to give, that error will be stored it in where? In the one more important header, that is error number dot h. So this is the header which is going to hold the error number. So whatever the number, whatever the value it is going to return. So for every API it is returns the integer value. That value is going to be stored it in error number dot h. So whatever the value, that value you can refer it in the this header file. Now you will get to know what error it is. Now P error function, as I said, the P error function you can make use for all the APIs. So if any error is occurred while executing the API, so you can make use of the P error function to display the error message. Now last one, same as P error, you can make use of the STR error. So this is the one more function we are going to use. For what purpose? To display the error message. So where the error message it is going to display? It is going to be displayed in the log file. So that we are going to call it as a error log file. So str error is going to display the error message. It is redirect the error into the log file. But p error function, it is going to redirect the error into the standard output. So this is what the two different between the P error and the STR error. So these are the common characteristics that is going to be supported both the Unix as well as the POSIX. Now this error number, as I said, there will be plenty of error it is going to give. So what are that error? We are going to list it out. As I said, it is going to give though, that is error number dot h is going to give though the many errors, right? So these are the few error status code as well as its meaning. So now E axis. So what is that E axis? E indicate that it is an error. So now the process does not have though, the process does not have though access permission. Does not have the access permission for any file. So in that cases it is going to give the E axis error. Now suppose for example EPRM, that is nothing but the error permission. Now the process does not have the permission, that is the permission is nothing but it does not have the super user privileges. So in that cases it is going to return EPRM. So now E no ENT, that is indicate that no, not a valid file name. So in that case it is going to introduce the error, that is E no ENT. Now bad F, that indicate that if the processor is going to make use of the bad file pointer, that is whatever the file pointer you are used in your API is not the correct one. So in that cases it is going to gives the bad F. Now similar to that, interrupt. So while executing any program or any signal, in that cases the signal is going to interrupt your program. So in that cases there will be an error. So in that case EINTR introduced. Now E again. So what it indicate? Suppose for example while executing or while writing some data to the file. So in that cases, so some output device you required. So in that cases you are going to suspend that process, and again you are going to come back to access to write the content to the file. So in that cases you can make use of the E again. Now E no memory, that is if though enough it does not have the enough memory. So in that cases it is going to give though E no memory. So while executing IO operation, so it may cause though input output input output error. So that is EIO. So now while reading and writing the data to the pipe, so there will be some error is going to be occur. Now suppose for example you are going to write the data to the file, but it does not have the read permission. In that cases, EPIPE is going to be exit. Now next one, EChild. So you are not able to create the child process. So by the parents, in that cases, it is going to give an EChild B. So these are the few error status code. So there are few many error code I listed out here with the meaning. So this is about the last topic. So that is POSIX and the UNIX APIs. So this finish out the first module. Now let us brief out what we studied in the from the beginning. Thank you.